So, hello everyone, I'm Guillermo Moliní. I work at Webcrafters, which is a small firm dedicated mainly to GPU computing. We have been doing a lot of machine learning projects during the past years, and eventually we became very interested in natural language processing. The main goal of this talk is to give you an introduction of what we understand natural language processing is, and to make a case for the need of GPU computing in machine learning in general, and in particular in language, in natural language processing. So this is the roadmap we're going to follow. First, we're going to talk a little bit about what we understand NLP is, and we're going to see some use cases. Then we are going to analyze one of those use cases, in particular searching in a database, and how it has been traditionally done. And we are going to look a little bit at the problems it has. And then we are going to talk about what we think would be the solution of that problem, which is modern NLP, and in particular vector embeddings, which is the method that we are currently using. We are going to explain what they are and how they work. And we are going to make our case for the need of GPUs. Then we are going to do a practical example of them using a demo of WebScript News. If you have read the extract, it said it was going to be about the ArcSib scientific database, but we thought it could be better to use something easier to understand. And then we are going to talk about another possible application of vector embeddings, which is to improve speech to text. So what is natural language processing? Natural language processing are the computational techniques used for analyzing and representing text for the purpose of achieving human-like language processing. What this means is that we want the computer to actually understand language as humans do. It's a little bit like when we start to learn how to read. So you start with letters, and then you go to the syllables, and then you are able to make up words. And right now, a computer is a little bit like that. They can distinguish words, they can know which letters they are, but they don't really understand them. If you give an economics book to an eight-year-old, he can probably read it, but he's not going to understand anything. And this is what we feel is more or less the case in computer right now. So if we actually achieve natural language processing, what would be some of its use cases? Well, first of all, searching for information in a database. And by this, I don't mean Google. Google is great for finding web pages, which have a very particular structure. They have links. And they have also the input of millions of users, which is usually not the case. We have information extraction. Imagine we want to classify all incoming communications or emails so that they can be properly forwarded to each department. Then we first need to extract the information of that communication, understand what it's about, and then so that we can properly classify it. Summarization, in case we have a lot of documents and I need to prioritize them, it could be nice if a tool could actually make me a summary and I could then prioritize and decide which one is more interesting for me. Question answering, for example, in online courses right now, the only way to make an exam is to do a test. With these kind of things, you could actually provide a professor's answer to an essay, and then you could compare semantically that essay the professor has written to everything the student has written and see whether they are talking about the same stuff. Customer interaction with chatbots, sentiment analysis, not only know what they are talking about, but whether it is good or bad. And finally, speech to text, which we'll come back later, which is the ability to transcribe audio and video into its written form. So now we're going to center ourselves in one of those use cases, which is searching in a database. And if you remember for the example I gave earlier, right now, searching is like an eight-year-old. They can distinguish words, but they don't know what they mean. They do some tricks in order to palliate that thing, which, for example, they use stemming, which would mean that buying and buy are interpreted as the same word. They sometimes use synonyms, dictionaries, they do tagging in order to speed the search, because when you search in long pieces of text, it's really slow, so they do tagging. They usually have misspelling support, and they do page ranking. But let me put to you an example. So what if I tell you, imagine something with this word, a seal? Well, you could very possibly be thinking about the animal, a seal. But if you were writing a letter, and I know that nobody does this now, you could probably want to seal it after you have written it. Or if I was talking about the US Navy, I could be talking about the US Navy SEALs. And what I want to highlight with this is that context is really important in human language. Just a few words in a sentence can completely change its meaning. And when you are just trying to match, that's a problem. And that's what traditional tester does. In the example earlier with the seal, imagine I had a database and I had tagged it with that word, every of the documents, seal, seal, and seal. If I looked it up and I wanted to see, okay, retrieve me all the documents of the US Marines, it couldn't retrieve that photo because I haven't tagged everything that I needed, and the computer didn't understand my query. So our proposition and what we think is working best right now is what we call modern natural language processing, and in particular, vector embeddings. Vector embeddings are a technique used to actually embed a word into a vector. So you have to transform a word into an n-dimensional vector, which it doesn't really matter the, well, it matters in depends on the applications, but the dimensions you can use from 50 to 1,000, depending on what you want to do. For the example we are going to use earlier, we are using vectors of around 300 dimensions. So how do you come to get these vectors? Well, you need to do a process which is training. And in a lot of ways, it works like a neural network. You start with some randomly initialized vectors, and then you start giving them documents. And with each document, it will see at every word the words around it, and then it will compute the values taking into account the words that surround it. The really interesting thing about this is that you can train with anything. Anything works, as long as you have enough documents to train the vectors. So you can train like we have done with the Wikipedia, which gives us a really broad language base. But you can also train with specific languages, even, for example, with codes. And it will get the relationships in between the words. For the demo later, as I have said, we have trained with the Wikipedia, which consists of 1.6 billion words and produces a dictionary of 1.7 million unique words. There are several ways to do it. The most famous one are GloVe and Word2Vec, which one was developed by Socher at Stanford University, and the other three main ones actually by Mikolov, first at Google, now he's at Facebook. And we have actually also parallelized one of those, the GloVe training algorithm, and we will be releasing it if anybody wants to use it. So how do exactly the vectors work? Well, welcome back to Math 101. So if you remember from math class, a vector similarity is given by its cosine. When the cosine is near zero, it means the vectors are very different, and when it's near one, they are very close. And because our words now are represented as vectors, it gives us the semantic information, the semantic closeness. So for example, here, ball and Mars don't have anything to do, and therefore their vectors are very separated and its cosine is going to be near zero. If you have ball and football, which are two concepts that are very similar, then the vector's cosine will be near one. But we can do a lot more operations. We can add, we can subtract. Let's see an example of that. So we are going to take the concept United Kingdom, and we are going to subtract the word London, and then we are going to add the concept of Spain. So what do you think the resulting vector will be? Well, yeah, that was easy. It was Madrid, obviously. And why I think this is a very classic example of how vector embeddings work, and why I think it's great, because it conveys how many information the vector embeddings have. This is the same as saying the United Kingdom is to London as to Spain is to what? And asking that question to a computer, and the computer is actually able to answer it. So if vector embeddings are so good, why are they not used? Well, first of all, there's quite a steep learning curve. We have seen the basic stuff, cosines, adding, subtracting, and everything. That's easy. But if you want to do dev stuff, it can be quite complicated. And also, the main problem is it's the computational power you need. It's slow and it's expensive. Remember that we are doing operations of very large vectors. And you have a large database, let's put 10 million documents. You need to do 10 million operations for every search you do in that database. So because we are experts in GPU computing, our answer to that problem, obviously, is GPU computing. So I don't know if you know what a GPU is. Is the graphic card that is in your laptop or desktop with which you play. And it turns out that you can actually program them and make computations with it. And the main difference between a CPU and a GPU is the number of cores. With a CPU, you have 4, 8, 16, maybe 32 in a really good one. With just an average GPU, like the one you have at home, you can have 1,500 cores. Admittedly, they don't do the same stuff, but if you can program them rightly, and it depends also on the algorithm, you can have really great speedups. And this is really a good example given by NVIDIA, and this is actually from a couple of years ago, from 2013 or something. Google had the Google Brain project, which was a cluster of around 2,000 CPUs. Which had cost them $5 million. And they used this cluster, funnily, to find kitten in YouTube videos. They trained a whole neural network just to find kitten. I mean, how much money do you have to spend $5 million just to find kitten in videos? Well, it turns out they substituted that whole cluster by just 3 GPUs, which had more cores than the whole other cluster, and which just cost them $12,000. And that's not only interesting by itself, but the thing is that when they turned it on, it cost them 300 times less. And the thing is that it's getting better. It's getting even better. Basically, Moore's law in CPUs, it's already stagnating, but it hasn't stopped in GPUs. As you can see, the curve is very steep and it's going higher really fast. And I wanted also to give you an example in the application we are talking about. We have calculated the semantic closeness to 10 million documents using 300 dimensional vectors. And the result is, in a CPU, it's a little bit over 11 seconds. And in a GPU, it's just a little bit over 100 milliseconds. And what I find interesting in this graph is not only that it's 100 times faster using a GPU, but that it starts to make these algorithms usable. If you have to wait 11 seconds for an answer, in a lot of applications, you just can't use this method. If you take a tenth of a second, then it starts getting interesting. So now we are going to do a small demo of web scrape news. So let me change that. Yeah. So this demo uses the API. Is it there? No. OK. Can I see it there? Yes. So this demo uses the API, the semantic API we're developing. And first of all, we're going to do a search into the dictionary. We're going to try to find the closest words to the input we are going to give, which, if you remember, is a 1.7 million dictionary. So first of all, for example, I'm going to search for orange. Is it written right? Yes. Yeah. So can you see well? Yeah. So of course, orange gives us the colors. So the words that relate the most to orange are all colors. So what happens if now I give him more information? Let's tell him, OK, yeah, I'm talking about orange, but I really mean the fruit. So the semantic neighbors now are all fruit. Actually, unripe, which is a not well-known fruit, lemon, avocado, pomegranate, berries, and so on. Which is very interesting, because we have given the system more information, and it improves the search. Now we are going to go to the documents. Yeah. And we are going to search in a database that we have scraped over the web for around, I think it's 500,000 news. And we are going to search, for example, for war. There are a lot of words, sadly, now. And the documents are, it retrieves, they're all talking about war, but it's not a recent war. So for example, World War II, now the law of war, and the nonviolent struggle, and everything. So let's give him more information of what we want to find. So for example, we are going to give him Damascus. So we're in Damascus. And voila, now all the documents that are closest to this search relate to Syria. And what is interesting here is that the word Damascus doesn't appear until the fourth example. So it has actually understood that war in Damascus means it's a war in Syria. And it's looking for all the documents related to that search. There's also another quite useful. So if we search for peace talks, it gives us, for example, documents about Israel and the Palestinians, and also full of fear and everything. And if we see the fifth document, for example, it's the UN leaders express unlimited conditional support on a ceasefire in Minsk. It's talking about the conflict in Ukraine. So they say, OK, this interests me. So I actually want to find the documents that are talking about this. So we can actually give it to him. And then all the results are actually talking about the conflict in the Ukraine and the talks between the EU and Russia. And again, it has understood that the more information we actually give this engine, the more it understands, so the better it can search. And we can do this also in other languages because they are word vectors. So if we search the, change this to the spa, no, spa, yes. Title. And now we are going to give it weights. And update the settings. And we go back. Then we can search again. Guerra. Asco. And it retrieves again the documents just in another language. And this is the good thing. We have trained with both the English Wikipedia and the Spanish Wikipedia, and they still contain the information. And what is interesting here also is that in this case, we also retrieve the titles of the news, and which this means that you can combine them, and you can tell the algorithm, okay, I want 70% of the result to be of the weight of the result to be given to the title, and 30% to the content. So now let's go back to the presentation. Yeah. So what's really interesting about word vectors is not only everything we have just seen, but that they are the basic foundation of a lot of applications related to natural language processing. For example, if you wanted to do semantic sentiment analysis, you just need to add a small neural network on top of it, and then you get also whether a phrase has been good or bad. Socher, which is now at Salesforce because his company was bought, is doing really interesting stuff where he combines a neural network for this, detecting images and the vector embeddings, and then he asks the computer to actually describe an image. And he would tell, okay, tell me what this image is about. And the answer would be actual text saying, okay, this is a person playing tennis. And what is it holding in his hand? Well, he's holding a racket and he's hitting a ball. All that kind of stuff you can build on top of word vectors. Or for example, the example we are going to see now, which is speech to text, which you can improve with the use of this technique. So now we are going to go to the final part of this talk, which is speech to text. Speech to text is the ability to automatically transcribe video and audio into its written form. And why is that useful? Well, it's useful, first of all, because it's time saving. Imagine you have 1,000 hours of video and you need to decide whether they're interesting or not. In video, the fastest you can go is actually watching the video. So you have to spend 1,000 hours to actually classify all of them. If you could first actually get a written transcription, you can apply everything we have talked about. You could search inside the text. You could ask him whether it was good or bad. You could summarize it. You could produce, obviously, closed captioning, which is automatic subtitles. But everything we have talked about of the applications of word embeddings, you can apply to video and audio. You could ask YouTube to get you, okay, I want the minutes of every news that talks about Trump because I just want to see that part of the video. And how the I'm going to explain a little bit about how the algorithm works. And basically, you start with a wave and you need to get the phonemes. This is typically done with a neural network, a deep neural network. I'm not going to go very deep into that, but it's just enough to say that the first step you need to do is convert the wave into the phonemes. And then with those phonemes, which are more or less ordered, you need to transform them into words. And by that, we need a dictionary. But it's a special kind of dictionary. It's a probabilistic dictionary, which tells you for each phoneme and its possible combination of phonemes, the probability that the next word is going to be any other given word. And this is best seen with the following example. For example, so we have here, So ball, bull, ballet, which are all words that have very similar phonemes. And we have here market, marshmallow, which would be the next step, which also have very similar phonemes. And between this step and this one, we have arrows with weights. And those weights are the probability that from this word, it's very probable that the next word is going to be that one. And if you see here, for example, well, bull and Mars, the probability is very low. Because, I mean, what's the probability of a bull, actual bull being in Mars is really, really low. Whereas with Mars, it's a lot higher because Mars is a field in the mountains and you could actually expect a bull to be there. So if we recapitulate a little bit, you have the wave, then you get the phonemes, and then with those phonemes and the dictionary of probabilities, you get a phrase. And for example, we could get this phrase, a bull market is a good chance for investors. Does anything strike you as odd with this phrase? There's something that doesn't really quite add up. This, well, you're probably thinking, a bull market. What the hell is a bull market? Why would it be a good chance for investors, a bull market? Well, the phrase should have actually been a bull market is a good chance for investors, because a bull market is a rising market. And what happened here? Well, the dictionary of probabilities we used had the probabilities all flat because it was very broad. And bull usually doesn't appear on the Wikipedia, for example, related to market or to investors, because it appears as the concept of animal. And therefore, it was a lot more probable to find bull or bolt or any other word, but not the bull, the animal. So how could we improve this? Well, our opinion is that it can be improved, again, using word and vector. So we need to actually find the theme of what you are trying to transcribe and then help the algorithm with that knowledge. And the concept is a little bit like, well, let's do several rounds of processing. First one, we will get the first result, which is a bull market is a good chance for investors. We will extract the theme in this phrase, which is pretty easy because, well, you have market and you have investors, so you know they are talking about economics. Then let's go, for example, to Wikipedia, get all the books we can, well, all the articles we can about economics, and then compute a new dictionary or language model so that the algorithm actually now uses a very specific language, a very specific economic language. And after that, we will just reprocess everything and let the algorithm decide whether the first hypothesis was the correct one or not. The problem with this, again, as we have seen earlier, is that it's costly and it is very slow. And therefore, we are also proposing here the use of GPUs. And actually, I went a little bit fast, so now if anybody has any questions, I can answer most of them. If they are very math-related, I have their help also to let me answer the questions.
Yeah, I have a question regarding if you are working with any underlying model to describe the semantics, or you just apply words being together.
No, that's the beauty of it. We don't give it a model. The algorithm is a little bit like a neural network in that is unsupervised. So you just feed it documents, and it sees you can tweak some of the parameters, like, for example, how many words far away you want to look. So, for example, I can tell you, okay, for a given word, compute its value just looking at the next 7 words and the last 7 words, or just 2 of them. But the beauty of it is that you don't give it a specific model. It learns by itself.
I have actually 2 questions. The first one will be, I saw the scores, they are kind of low in the sense when you were making the demo, you got like 70, and if I speak about percentage, will be about 70% confidence or something like that. Mm-hmm. This will be the first one. And the second one will be, what do you What do you think are the limitations in case that you train the algorithm with several, with multi-languages? In the sense that casa in Spanish will be aligned with house, even that the algorithm doesn't know that it means the same?
Well, so to the first question, yeah, the score gives us the closeness, so it would mean that it thinks it's more or less a 70% close, but we have to be careful with that, because it's not that clear where the bar is, and it depends on how you train. Maybe 70 for some applications is really close, and it's what you're looking for, and for other ones are 50. So you need to analyze a little bit what you as a human accept for closeness. And could you repeat me the second one? in languages, yeah. So it depends on how you train. For the demo that we have used two languages, we actually created two separate dictionaries so that they can overlap. The main problem if you just train a lot of it is that you can confuse the English words with the Spanish terms. But it always depends on, usually in this kind of thing, with the amount of documents you give it. And also there's another problem with just one global dictionary for everything, and is that it's really, really big. So usually you don't want that. With the GPUs, it helps with the size of the dictionary, but it's better if you keep it confined to one language or one application.
So will it find English and Spanish words for the similar to the one you are querying for? I mean, if you search for casa, will it find both roof and tejado? Or will it be two independent languages encoded in a single dictionary?
In this case, it would be independent, because when you have trained, you never use casa near roof. So it takes the meaning, but the meaning with the words that are used around it. So if you actually use documents mixing the languages, then it could get both roof and house. So it depends on the documents you feed.
Yeah. So if you give it both, you could be just computing a single dictionary with two disconnected parts.
Correct. Yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
See? Regarding the training phase that you have said that, of course, is slower on normal CPUs and can be executed faster using GPUs, do you have some numbers? For example, I don't know if you really train or calculate your vectors using Wikipedia or other sets of documents. Do you have numbers about really how much it takes to calculate the vectors?
The vectors. So funny that it depends, obviously, how many documents you give the algorithm. So for example, for the Wikipedia, you use GenSim, which is a tool to calculate with Word2Vec. It takes, I believe it's maybe 10 hours or something like that. And the GPU version, it's a little bit above 2. But the problem is that it isn't still in GitHub, because there's a small funny bug somewhere which makes it work sometimes, and it doesn't. Sometimes it doesn't, and the vectors don't convey anything. So we really need to find that bug. But yeah, it's faster. But really, for a lot of applications, the training time is not that important. There are some applications that is interesting, but the training time is usually not that important, because once you have the language base, you can apply it to any given database. So if I have, for most databases, just the English version of Wikipedia would probably be enough, because if it's just news, for example, they use the normal language, and that would work. So you may not need to train that many times. What is the problem, or why we think GPUs are really important, is when you apply that actually in an application.
Okay, so thank you very much, Guillermo.
Okay, thank you.